Everybody, it's Carolyn Hamlett. I've been gone for quite a while. I was diagnosed with cancer in July of 2017. Right now it's the end of June 2018. It's been quite a battle. But I think with everything I've gone through, I have a feeling that we've licked this thing. And having cancer is a battle. It really is. And some people are able to treat it strictly with natural means. I found out that some cancers you have to treat it differently, and like the kind that I had, it was mostly estrogen fed. And although diet helps, it's a whole different type of a treatment. Didn't know there were so many different types of cancers and different types of treatments, but I'm really thankful for the group of doctors that I've had. I've been very blessed to have just, I believe, top-notch doctors. So my thanks goes out to them and to God to help me, to bring me to this point. And I want to thank everybody for their prayers. I can really feel the prayers that people have been praying for me. And just to know that people care is really been a big help. I've had a great support group. At first, I wasn't going to tell anybody that I had cancer, just because part of it is I didn't know anybody would really care. And I know some people would be happy. It sounds strange, but, you know, not everybody's, some people, I have enemies, you know, so there are some people that probably would love to see me suffer or die, and that's a shame that there's some people like that. I wouldn't wish this on anybody. I asked God that He would help me live, and because these are the end times, we don't have a whole lot of time left. I mean, for some people, 20 years seems like a lot of time. 10 years seems like a lot of time. I don't know how much time we have, but we're rapidly getting to the point where, well, it's scary. It's very scary for me because of being raised in the plan, and that's Satan's plan. And I knew that from a child. I knew the plan, how they were going to change people's spirituality, their perception of spirituality, and get it to the point where even Christians were going to be practicing the occult and calling it Christianity. We are in that time right now. I had no idea that Satan was going to be so successful, and how he's brought people to the place where they're actually embracing the occult. And so I asked God that he would help me live, that he would heal me, or, you know, work through the medicine, that he would give me the chance one more time, one more chance at least, to reach people with the truth. I have an idea that to present the material, what I've learned since I was a child, practically a baby, about the plan, what I've learned about the plan from the dark side, that I believe that I can reach more people with this, with a different way to present it. And so that's one of the things I'll be doing, that hopefully I'll be able to do some more writing. I want to do some videos. I'll be doing some videos with Lauren Grace, and hopefully some writing with her also. She's just a terrific writer, and I'm just so thankful for her. She's been so supportive to me through all of this in so many ways. And I couldn't answer emails anymore. I still can't. I mean, I don't have a lot of energy. It's been a long time since I've had energy. It's been years. And I didn't really realize how much the cancer was taking out of me physically until I had a mastectomy. The cancer was so progressed that the chemo helped, but it didn't do enough, so I had to have a bilateral mastectomy and lymph nodes removed. And hopefully that and the radiation treatments have taken care of everything. But the thing is, after the mastectomy, I actually started having some energy for the first time in years. So that's, you know, I'm hopeful that took care of the cancer, and then the radiation treatments have finished it off. But anyway, Lauren has picked up just she's picked up the slack, which is a lot. Answering emails, she took over my Facebook page after I asked her. I just couldn't do it anymore. And I couldn't answer emails. Well, you know, when we started our Ask Carolyn and Lauren, I had every intention in working with Lauren, us together, and answering questions and answering emails, making videos together. It just got to the point where I couldn't. And I'm just so thankful that Lauren was inspired, and I believe she has been truly gifted by God to bring the information to everybody, and in her wonderful articles. I mean, it's been such a relief for me what she has been putting out there. Some things that my name was put on, they were written by her, but maybe I had made a suggestion here or there. You know, she always asks me what I would, you know, if I have any suggestions. And most of the time, there's nothing else I would suggest, because she covers so much and even more than I would ever even think to cover. It amazes me. She knows so much. And she's a very, very humble person. She's one of those people that to know she just inspires me to be a better person, because I think she's a better person than I am. She's more, as much as I try to get to a complete point and explain something just with complete honesty, I can say that Lauren is even more that than I am. And I mean, it's like she's really, really clear and intent on making sure that there's never any assumptions. When she's bringing forth material and she or I both are looking at the scriptures and doing our studies, doing our word studies in the Bible, we're just very careful not to read into what God's written word is saying. We look at it in context. We're being honest. We're being honest with ourselves. This is it's such a responsibility to have a platform where people listen. They listen to us. And we don't want anybody to follow us. Don't follow any man or any woman. We're pointing people back to the Bible. We want you to go back, read it for yourself in context, get the true gospel of Jesus Christ. And you aren't going to get it from listening to somebody tell you, spoon feed it to you. It's very, very dangerous, especially in this day and age. So what I hope to do, and Lauren and I hope to do together, is to inspire you first of all, to remind you what the Word of God says. And a lot of things that people are missing out is so much of it has to do with the lifestyle of what a Christian is, what a Christian should be. No one's teaching repentance. I mean, I don't see it out there. I don't hear it. Nobody's teaching righteousness. Those things are being left out. And the best way, the best spiritual warfare there is if you walk according to the will of God. That way, you don't leave any doors open for the occult. This is not being taught. This is not being encouraged. So Lauren and I will be encouraging you to go back and look at what the Bible has to say for how we're supposed to be. We're supposed to pick up our cross and follow Jesus. Now, what does that mean? I hope that you will go check that for yourself. What does it mean to pick up your cross and follow Jesus? It isn't, people aren't doing that. And so they're falling for the counterfeit, and they're falling for deception after deception. But anyway, another thing is I wanted to let everybody know that the book that Lauren and I wrote together, it'll be about a year in August that it came out. We worked very hard on that, many, many hours. And some of the time I was not feeling well enough to do much, so she'd have to wait until I was able to do some things with her. But I want everybody to know, I mean, people will email me or they'll comment on my Facebook public figure page, and they'll say something to the effect of your book, you know, like it's my book. I want everybody to know that it's not my book. I'm a co-author. And in fact, Lauren's name is on there ahead of mine for a reason. I wanted it that way, not because I'm such a humble person and Lauren should be first and all that. No, it's because that book would not even be here if it wasn't for her. She did most of the work. She did most of the writing. I did very little writing on the book. I helped occasionally. I mean, we worked together as we were writing it. She did the organizing it. We put our research together. It wasn't like I didn't have a part in it. Yes, I did. We both worked so well together in that there's certain areas that I was able to do a little extra research in that she was not able to at the time, and vice versa. So we did work well together on that book, but it absolutely wouldn't be here if it wasn't for her. And I don't know how to do a lot of things that she did with the organizing of the book that she just did. And I'm just so thankful for that. So I'm a co-author, and it's much of it was her work. So I am hoping that soon I'll be able to put out some more articles. It's just heavy on my heart. You know, it would be so much easier for me to just put all this behind. I mean, people have said to Lauren and me both, they'll just say, oh, you just want attention. You're doing this for that, you know, this, whatever. The thing is, you know, the kind of attention we get. Most of the time we get terrible criticism, and it's, well, I guess one analogy, I've wanted to give this analogy before. I don't think I have, but this is how I feel that I just, okay, it's hard. It's really hard to do this, because it'd be so much easier just to forget it all. But I can't, and she can't, because we care about you, and we take abuse from lots of people. There's people lying about us. I mean, I've been doing this for over 30 years, trying to expose what Satan's plan is. Over 30 years. I mean, I'm. You'd think I'd be used to it. I kind of am, but the same thing is, it's part of the program. It's just, that's what we deal with. You know, and if we think we're anybody special, I look at Jesus. I look at the apostles. Look what they suffered. It's like they were not looking for something for themselves. They cared. It's just, that's how I am. That's how Lauren is. And I mean, if it ends up my last words are trying to send someone to the truth, so be it. I mean, I'm gonna try to do this till the day I die. I don't know when I'm gonna die. I don't think anybody really knows when they're gonna die, but I just pray God gives me the time to at least put out the information one more time to try to reach the people. And there's so many different types of people and viewpoints that if they heard my testimony and knew what I came from, maybe they would believe me that the truth about Jesus Christ, that he is Savior. And I'll explain in some of the upcoming videos I plan to do. This one's already tons longer than I thought I'd do, but I'll explain more about what salvation is. I don't think people know why we need a Savior. That's number one. You know, I don't understand why anybody would even deny what God has offered us. They don't understand the situation. God's not real to people. Satan's not real to people. If it was, they wouldn't be doing the things they're doing. I want to get this point across to people. This is no joke. This is absolutely no joke. And I thank God I'm alive and he's kept me alive so that I can try one more time. And hopefully he'll it's up to him to reach the people. It is. So that I end up interrupting myself all the time. I apologize. I'm not the best speaker. There was an example I was going to give a few minutes ago that I'll give now, that it's the way I feel a lot in my trying to reach people and my how I keep on keeping on. And it's a story about when I was a competitive swimmer in Florida back in the 60s. Back then, people took for granted that freestyle meant any style. I mean, you can swim any swim stroke, when it's a freestyle event. People have forgotten that. Well, I happened to be a faster backstroker than most people could freestyle. So I signed up for, I think it was a 400 yard, might have been longer than that. I was a good long distance swimmer, but it was probably a 400 yard freestyle event. I started the first length off in freestyle. Then when I did my flip turn, I came out and did backstroke, and I was swimming backstroke, and I was taking a lead because I was faster than those people, just because I was, you know. So people started running up and down the side of the pool, yelling at me. Judges were jumping in. There were even judges jumping in the water trying to get me out. Swimmers trying to get me out. I knew that if I touched the bottom of the pool, I was disqualified. So there's no way I'm going to touch the bottom of the pool. I'm swimming, and I'm yelling back at them. I'm going swimming, and I'm going, hey, read the rule books. Read the rule book. I was watching my coach. My coach knew what I was going to do before I did the race. I checked it out with him. I was watching him, and he was spurring me on. He was, yeah, go for it. Yeah, so anyway, this analogy is the way I look at my Christian walk, and it's the way that I look at, well, I hope that you will look at your Christian walk, and I also look at it as when I want to show people what the truth is. It's like they're trying to get me out of the race. I'm in my swim lane, minding my own business, being where my coach wants me to be. That's who God is. I look at God as my coach. How do I know who God is? Well, I know because of the Bible. You know, you don't know who he is. You guess. Lots of people are out there guessing. It's like, well, I believe that this and that. Well, you know what? It doesn't matter what you believe. What you believe can be so wrong. This is serious. You need to find out what God is like. He needs to be your guide. You need to follow him. And he gives you, you need to obey him. You know, a good coach, when I was a swimmer, I was blessed to have good coaches or I never would have been any good. I followed what the coach told me to do. I trusted my coach. So in swimming, fortunately, I had good coaches that I could trust. That doesn't always happen in life. I found out that you can have other types of coaches that you can put your trust in, and you found out otherwise. Well, you know, you trust in God, and you have a love for the truth. You must have a love for the truth. You must love God, and he'll bring you out. He'll show you the way. But back to the story about the swimming. I finished the race. I didn't win. You know, that was... Maybe I would have if I hadn't had people jumping out into the pool trying to stop me, grabbing me, physically grabbing me, and trying to drag me out of my lane. I was determined to stay in my lane, do what my coach told me to do, and continue the race. I finished it, and I wasn't disqualified. And I'm going to finish this race, and I'm not going to be disqualified. I absolutely will not. And I don't care how many of you in there, out there, think that you want to disqualify me. You know, the rule book is the Bible. You call yourself a Christian, that should be your rule book, not some new revelation that somebody gave you or you might have channeled. You know, you call stuff... You know, you think that you're hearing from the Holy Spirit, are you? You know, you get a word from the Lord. Is that really a word from the Lord? Or are you channeling something? How do you know? There are a lot of people who have had occult backgrounds who have never renounced anything. You know, they become Christians and are told, lots of Christians are told that you get saved, you put your old life behind. And actually, lost my train of thought. That's pretty good, though, for as late as it is. Ah, great. Where was I? This is where I need somebody like Lauren on here to get me back on track. But anyway, maybe that's a good place to stop anyway. It's like I'm preaching, and a lot of people don't want to hear this. But anyway, I just wanted to let everybody know that I care about you, and I'm thankful for the ones that do pray for me and the ones that are throwing the vegetables at me or the ones that are trying to get me out of my swim lane. You know, I still have a heart for you, and I want you to know the truth of who Jesus Christ is. I don't want you to be separated eternally. You know, it's this is true that we do need a Savior. And I see so many people that I think are probably not going to make it. And I see them going so far off following people. They're following people, and they're following after gifts and abilities. And so many people that are calling themselves Christians are no different than what I used to be when I was in the Luciferian hierarchy. I called myself a Christian back then. My mother called herself a Christian. But at that time, she knew she was Luciferian. But she considered herself a type of Christian. We're not far from that now. With Christians, they're already accepting the term mystic Christian. There's no such thing as a mystic Christian. You cannot be a mystic and a Christian at the same time. A lot of people would say that I'm wrong. Well, if you will give me a chance, when I'm able to get back and give my testimony, and maybe some of you will send in questions that you would like for me to answer about some of my background. But the only reason to use any of my background to share with people is not for the woo. You know, it started out where I wanted to share my testimony and so that you can see where I came from, so that you would know that I know what I'm talking about. But so many people have taken it to the woo factor part, and they're missing the whole point. And they've gone off away from the truth, because that's what's important to them, all the interesting woo stuff. So when I'm going to be telling you what I've been through, there's a lot I won't tell you, and I've already told too much on some of the other videos I've made, and I'm ashamed of it. I wished I hadn't. I was encouraged to talk about certain topics or woo things. And now I know why I was encouraged to do it. Now those very topics are being twisted and used. I shouldn't say twisted. They're actually being used to springboard into the occult. So is another reason why I'm wanting to share the truth with people. I feel responsible for the fact that people are taking even things that I said that in my old videos, that I was infected with some of this stuff that's now being taught about what spiritual warfare was. I was wrong about some stuff. I have to tell you that I was wrong, and I wish nobody would even look at the old videos I did, because it's mixed with some, there's things in there that, you know, it's easy to be fooled. But when you go back to the Word of God in context and do word studies and you love God with all of your heart, you're going to come out of that. And I hope that all the people that might have been encouraged to go a certain route with spiritual warfare that even I encouraged, that they'll come back and realize the truth that I knew anyway, but it's kind of like I got separated from that truth. And the truth that the best spiritual warfare you can do, and this is what Paul was talking about. He was the Apostle Paul. It's metaphorically, he was talking about the armor of God. What protects you from the enemy is walking in righteousness. It's obeying God. You know, people shudder like, obey, I'm not going to obey God, I hate to obey, you know. Well, if you look at what God wants you to do, it's not grievous. It's, unless you love lying, you know, do you like lying? Do you like stealing? Is that what you like to do? Do you think that that's wrong, that somebody's going to keep you from stealing? Do you think it's wrong that you shouldn't lie? That somebody's going to tell you you can't lie anymore? Well, they're harm. Harm comes from that. You harm other people. That's not God's ways. So the point is, if you're living in truth, you live according to Jesus Christ, his ways. He said, if you've seen me, you have seen the Father. He showed us who his Father is. He said everything he did because his Father showed him. He saw it from his Father. The miracles he did, he said it was the power of his Father. It came from his Father. It was the glory for the glory of the Father. That's not what a lot of people are doing today, too. They're seeking the gifts, and they're looking for power. They're no different than the people in the occult. This isn't. If you want to go back, if you want to see how we should be when it comes to certain so-called gifts, go back to the book of Acts and see how Peter was. See how he treated the situation with bringing healing to a lame man. And what it brought, he put the glory to God. It wasn't like he was going, like he thought he was a great healer. Thousands of people were added to the church because of one healing. So study that about how we should be as Christians. So when you walk in the ways of darkness, when you walk in the ways of Satan, which is lying, which is stealing, idolatry, which I believe the Bible said is covetousness too. There's lots of things that if you walk the way of Satan, you open the door to Satan. You've opened the door to the occult, to be not Holy Spirit guided, but guided by unholy spirits. It's a fact. That's why the Bible tells you to repent. That's completely turning away from something. You have to be sorrowful. You know, there should be fruit of repentance. Like Jesus told the Pharisees, I think it was Jesus. No, actually it was John the Baptist, sorry. But he told them, it's like, show fruit worthy of repentance. And if I'm wrong about who it was, you know, you can certainly find it in the Bible. I mean, I'm learning, and I know a lot more about the Bible than I used to because I'm reading it and I'm loving it. You know, if you love God, you're going to love that. You're going to love reading the Bible. But now while I'm thinking of it, and I'll try to just wrap this thing up here. One of the Bibles that I do use King James Version. That seems to be a very popular one that people use. I use the Strong's Concordance with that to do my word studies. That helps. I love the Good News for Modern Man, or the Good News Translation. And the reason I do is, one of the reasons is because it was the Bible that was given to me when I was about 12 years old. That this Bible was actually, I mean, I had read the King James when I was a little kid, and I was taught how to interpret it according to different religions or different types, branches of Christianity, you know, out of context, of course. But this was the first time that I ever read a Bible like a book, because that's how it was written. And that was when I really realized that Jesus Christ wasn't what I had been taught that he was. He was not a low ascended master. He was the Son of God. So in one way, it's kind of hard to describe how this happened, but I guess a lot of people understand compartmentalizing. And when you're still influenced by the dark side, the occult, then they can actually prevent you from fully seeing the truth. So the thing is that part of me still considered him like part of the spiritual hierarchy that belonged to Satan, although at that time I thought it was God's spiritual hierarchy. But it was, you know, like it's kind of hard to describe that real in just a short video of how I could believe that was God's spiritual hierarchy, but I did. But the important thing is, I saw a different Jesus. I saw a man, a powerful man, not in the fact that he did miracles. I saw power in his love. I wasn't looking for power. It was his love, his honesty, his compassion, his judgment. He had righteous judgment. Yes, we're supposed to judge, but it's righteous judgment. What is righteous judgment? Do a Bible study. Find out what righteous judgment is. Jesus had so many wonderful qualities, and it just touched my heart. That was the night I was about 12 years old, and I said a prayer to God. I never been told anything about salvation. I didn't know anything about it. But I said a prayer that night because I knew that I was dirty compared to Jesus, and I wanted to be a better person. I wanted to be like him, not, you know, like next to like Jesus himself kind of thing, but it's just like he's a good person, and he knew he was more than just what I'd been taught that he was. He wasn't somebody to like there's a pecking order in that Satan spiritual hierarchy. Well, they had Jesus pretty much down on the bottom rung. You know, nobody pays attention to Jesus. They just want to quote a couple of things out of the Bible out of context, like people are doing today in Christianity, and calling it Christianity when it's actually a cult. They take stuff out of context. It's, you know, don't take somebody's word for it out of context. Go read it for yourself. So anyway, that night I prayed to God and I asked God to help me be more like Jesus. And I actually shed some tears, and which, you know, because it just touched me, and I felt the presence of God, and it just was overwhelming. And I had a problem with gossiping back then. I was in junior high school and I was terrible. I was like a compulsion. Somebody would tell me something and I had to spread it, whether it was good or bad. It's like, I gotta tell somebody. I hated that about me. So I asked God to take that away from me, to help me so that I wouldn't be a gossip anymore. And it's like I never ever had that desire ever again. And you know, it got to the point where it wasn't soon after that, people were going, you know what, you never say anything bad about anybody. And they were talking about what a good person I was. And I didn't know I'd changed like that, but they noticed it. I had people telling me they noticed a change in me. So, you know, and a couple of them that were gossip said I wasn't fun anymore because I didn't gossip. And hey, you know, I just didn't have that in common with them anymore. But I did have something in common with people that were good people. So anyway, I'm not saying everybody should go to the Good News Bible, Good News for Modern Man. I like that because sometimes when I read it, it'll translate a word that is different than the translation in the King James. Then I will go to the Strong's Concordance and look up what the word means. And I find out that a lot of times the Good News for Modern Man translation is actually accurate. Like when it's talking about, like there's one verse that's talking about believing, you must believe with your whole heart, like, or believe in Jesus. The word believe, I wish I remember exactly what scripture that was, because I'll probably put it in an article sometime, but because it's really important. The word believe in the King James is actually used twice in this one verse. One of the believes, and this is most of the word believe translates to mean put your full trust in. It isn't just believing that Jesus was the Son of God and everything that led up to who he is, Savior, you know, Messiah. It's totally putting your trust, like putting your trust in him and that he is who he is, and you're just going to go with it. And then in that same scripture, the other believe actually means obey, and you must obey. That's interesting. There's a lot of obeys in the scriptures and the New Testament. And that's okay, you know, because if you're not obeying God, then who are you obeying? And if you're not obeying God, you've opened the door to be demonically inspired and you don't even know it. You know, you can be demonically inspired to the point where they can blind you to, you can't even see. You can read the Bible. So if you're blinded by a demonic spirit, you can read the Bible and think that you're actually getting the truth and you're not. So that's why if you need to repent and seek God, he'll help you. He'll cleanse you. You know, you have to take a break sometimes from some of this stuff that's these doctrines that are being passed around as Christianity when they're not. You want to know what Christianity is? You go to the Bible in context. Now, another translation is I like to look at is the Berean Bible. Now, there's lots of different translations. People get so used to the King James Version. I mean, I use it all the time, every day. But they get so used to it that they don't even think about what it says. Like the Lord's Prayer. How many times have you said the Lord's Prayer? You know, what some people call Our Father, or the Our Father. How many times have you said that? You don't really even think about what it means. You don't even know why Jesus even said it. You know, it's so. You think about it. Think about the words that are in King James. Go look, do word studies. That's going to help you. That'll help you a lot. And follow Jesus. You know, you got to pick up your cross and you have to follow him. And the path isn't easy and it's not going to get any easier. But you know what? Along the way, you're going to feel good about yourself. You're going to know it's the right thing to do. You're going to be strengthened as you go. You know, just the other day, I was reading about Stephen and, you know, Paul. And how Paul, I mean, actually he was Saul then. He was a young man, from what the Bible said, young Saul. And he had Stephen stoned. And Stephen saw the God, the heavens open up and saw Jesus at the right hand of the Father. I mean, he was being stoned, but there was a strength that God gave him there. And then I think about what the man that Saul became. That transformation can't happen unless you have had an experience with Jesus Christ, the real Jesus Christ. What kept him going? Have you ever thought about that? What kept Paul going? Why would he even bother? Maybe we should all go back and ask ourselves, why would he bother? And if you don't know why you would bother, then I hope that you can get to the point where that's the most important thing in your life. Not only, you know, it's not only salvation for yourself, but to spread the truth to other people, because this is a big deal. This is a real thing. Like I said, that we are running out of time, and things are going to get a lot darker. And it grieves my heart to see so many Christians being manipulated and falling for the tricks of the enemy. How many of them are... They think yoga and meditation is something that is Christian. There's a reason why God speaks against that in the Old Testament. I mean, they say Jesus meditated. Jesus didn't meditate. You find that in the Bible. It's not in the Bible. He did not meditate the way they're teaching now. That's the occult. Jesus didn't need to meditate. You know, did Jesus go to school when... You know, there's a lot of people that say that, some of them even call themselves Christians. You know, people talk a lot about the Bible. They're picking the Bible apart and go, well, you know, Jesus was taught by Egyptians or Indians or whatever, and that's how he got so wise. Well, he says how he got so wise, you know, because he came from the Father and he said what the Father said. That's God, you know, the creator of the universe. He didn't get what he learned from a human, from a person. And besides, there's parts in the Bible. I mean, I'm going off on this stuff, so I'll have to quit here, I think. But if you read the Bible, you will see that, like when Jesus was in the temple, if his parents, I mean, when he was 12 years old, he went back to Jerusalem, or he stayed in Jerusalem. I think that's what it was for the Passover, but I think that's what it was anyway. I have to go back and make sure I know why he was there, but he stayed back in Jerusalem, and he was in the temple talking to the, the priest or anyone, talking to people in the temple. They were amazed at what he knew. They didn't know how he knew what he knew. Well, his parents, when they found out that he was back in the temple, they were already on their way back home. And I think a couple of, 2 or 3 days out, they had to go back and get Jesus. So they knew, they were surprised. Everybody was surprised at what he knew. Don't you think that his parents would know if they had, if he had been off in India or Egypt or somewhere actually being taught specifically so-called mysticism and Gnosticism? Don't you think his parents would know that? Well, they sounded surprised when they went to pick him up. That's another part there. There's something else I found recently. I can't remember right now, but that shows that Jesus didn't learn anything from any human being. You know, that means that some other man was greater than him? No, I don't think so. Because there would be great problems over that person, that person would have followers, and, you know, that we'd be talking about him today instead of Jesus. But we're talking about Jesus because of who Jesus really is. So, man, I could go forever. But one last thought. Sorry about that, guys. I was going to make like a 5-10 minute video. Anyway, something that hopefully this will show what can happen to you when you think you've got, you think that you're operating properly in the head and everything. And when I first became a Christian, that was back in the 80s, 1980s. And anyway, I remember something out of one of the occult books or some of the occult books that I read, you know, and I thought, you know, I'm going to see what the Bible has to say about this. So although I used to have the books, they were from Lucius Trust, I used to have the whole set of books myself. When I became a Christian, I did what I knew I should. I burned the books, and they were worth quite a bit of money, but I burned them. I didn't care what they're worth. They just weren't worth having. So I went to the occult church I used to go to, went to their library, checked out about 3 books. I brought them home. I put them out on my dining room table along with the Bible. I took a look at, I went right to the books where I thought this, I can't even remember exactly what I was looking up, but the important thing was that I was able to see that in these books, all those years, 30 years or something, over 30 years, I wasn't reading the books that early. I was probably reading, I mean, people don't believe it, but I was actually looking at those books as soon as I could read. And that was, I actually knew much of the plan before I could read. So, elementary school. I knew I was reading those books elementary school. And they are, but anyway, I looked at these books and everywhere I thought I remembered, it was talking about the Christ. In Luciferianism, and in a lot of other religions or people that think that they don't have religion, but they believe that they speak the word the Christ. There's actually only one Savior, Jesus Christ, Christ being anointed one, chosen one. There's only one Jesus Christ from God. There are other ones that call themselves Christs or anointed ones. Those are from, you know, from Satan, not God's anointed ones other than God's prophets. But everywhere in this book were these books that were referring to the Christ, which is actually their planned global ruler or Antichrist is a possibility, but that's a whole nother thing, because I believe that there's probably going to be a fake Antichrist, but I've talked about that before. Still believe it's very possible. But anyway, everywhere what I was reading that it spoke of the Christ, it didn't say the Christ. It said Lucifer. And there was a lot of teaching of the 666. Now, I never saw the word Lucifer. All I saw was a Christ. But when I became a Christian, and I had repented and renounced everything, all of everything that I would dealt with and as a server in Satan's hierarchy, I gave up everything, my identity, everything that I had ever thought was true, is I threw it all away and started over. But when I gave my life to God, knew who Jesus Christ was, gave my life to God, repented of everything, asked God to cleanse me of all of the demonic stuff I had messed with, I was able to see. I was not deceived anymore with what I was seeing in my, like a demonic spirit before had blinded my eyes, so that when I was reading those books, my mind said to Christ, but my eyes actually had seen Lucifer. That stuff's happening right now to people. And Lauren and I mean, people that call themselves Christians, Lauren and I have described how that happens, and we described it in our book, The Doctrines of Demons, Exposing Christian Witchcraft. People could call themselves Christians all day long and not be a Christian. And it's what Dr. Summerall told me back in the 80s. He said it's a name tag people wear. You know, just because you put it on, so you call yourself a Christian, doesn't make it so. There are so many people like that today. They're calling themselves Christian, but they're practicing the occult. And the way that this can happen, one of the ways that is, it's so dangerous. We describe it in the book, in our book. It's under a section called fractal spirituality. There's fractal programming. And if you read this section in our book, maybe you'll understand how that works. Where it keeps somebody in a loop. They don't know that they're blinded by what actually is the truth in front of their faces. They can be shown the truth, and yet they can't. They think that they know the truth. Well, it's as bad as showing them the difference of black and white, and they still think white is black. And it makes perfect sense to them. It's like things make perfect sense to people that are fractally, that are caught up in the fractal programming, when they should be alarmed. It's almost like a whole group of zombies. Where, I mean, I didn't see any zombie movies or anything, but I basically get the idea of, is there like the Walking Dead? And these people, to me, are the Walking Dead. And not only mentally, but spiritually. And they're not comprehending things. They think they are. It's because there's a demonic, not only can it be a demonic entity that's influencing and blocking their discernment, but there's a type of programming that's going on. When you open the door to this stuff, this is not like years and years ago. There's some sophisticated stuff going on, and there's some really devilish stuff that is affecting people today in a way that has never affected people before. This is why I've got to try one more time to tell my testimony, because this stuff's been planned from my lifetime. I've seen Satan's plan transpire exactly how he said it would. But we've got to this point now, and it's scary. It is so scary to me because, I mean, I was told when I was a little girl that, well, the whole thing was to try to change people's, much of the plan was targeting, much of it was America, but Christianity, the enemy to the plan are Christians who believe in the Bible, biblically sound doctrine, biblically based, fundamental Christians. They're the enemies. I knew that when I was a kid. I was told the way they were going to change this. See, these were the Christians were holding up the plan, and mainly in America, because in America back in the 50s, in the 40s and 50s, there were a lot of Christian people here. There were, I'm talking too about, well, there's the morality involved. I grew up in an area. It was like post-World War II America. I have a blog article that maybe I should make it separate, just post-World War II America. We were a very moral society, and we were headed in a good direction. It was, there were a lot of Christian people, various denominations, a lot of Catholics, a lot of Jewish people. I grew up with a lot of Jewish people. We all had the same morals. We worked well together. We loved God. In our school system, it was, you know, one nation under God. We celebrated holidays. We celebrated Hanukkah even in school, along with Christmas. And we, you know, it was different back then. But that was a threat to the spiritual hierarchy, Satan's hierarchy and the plan. So the deal was, they made the plan, and this is straight from Satan. I mean, Satan's real, and people don't seem to realize that he is a real entity. And this is a life or death situation for real. So the plan was that they were going to invade Christianity. It was going to be like a slow process, and it has been up until recently, where they were finally, the end product was going to be where they were going to get people into the yoga, the meditation, into spirituality. They were going to use the UFO phenomena to bring people in. Music was going to be a major vehicle for this, music and television. The music greatly, of course, yes. They had some rock bands that they specifically used for this. But it was to bring people into the spirituality that in this new order age, they won't consider it a rigid religion. They will consider it the truth, but it actually isn't the truth, and it actually is Satan's religion and taking people away from the truth of God when they think that they're going to be free and loving, you know, love one another and you know, anything goes. It's a deception. It all sounds good on the surface. That was the goal, is to get people to the point where they embraced the supernatural. And that supernatural that everybody's embracing is Satan's domain. He has his demons out there impersonating angels of God, fallen beings. I mean, they're not all the same types of beings. Fallen angels, like his top ones, they're fallen angels. They're not ascended beings. They are fallen, evil angels. But the bad thing is that these things can impersonate goodness better than most Christians are good. It's they're so deceptive. So just because, I mean, like the section of the hierarchy that I was raised in, it's the white brotherhood, and that's where they call them the ascended masters. That's the most dangerous one, is because they're putting themselves off as being as pure and righteous and good, which they're not, and they loop people in there. You need your spiritual discernment, and you aren't going to get it by following those or taking they're feeding you them, and now some so-called Christian people are calling themselves Christian, feeding you scriptures out of context. So they quote a little Bible, so you think it's Christian. You know, why do you think use the word Christ? It's because they're trying to get you to think that the Bible, that they're actually using the Bible. They'll tell you the Bible is outdated, or there's, you know, it's for stupid people, pretty much, and that's all a lie. I'm telling you, it's absolute lie what they're saying. So the point is that they're getting people. I was told when I was a little girl that the end product is that Christians will think that they'll call themselves Christians, but they'll be practicing Luciferian. They will be practicing Satan's spirituality. They will be participating in the occult, and they will think that they are serving God. That's what I thought all those years. I thought I was serving God. Till I know I can thank God for this, that God allowed me to get to the point where I was able, where they took me to the top level. And in order for me to continue on the project I was working on at the time, back in the early 1980s, and it was bringing in some light beings. We actually opened up a portal that they needed humans to open up a portal. We were bringing in what I called light beings. Those very light beings today, they're parading around fooling people, thinking that they're of God when they're not. These things were brought in for a specific purpose back in the early 1980s. I was there when they were setting up the grid system around the earth with their stations of operation, their targeted areas. I was there from the beginning of the project. And you know something interesting? When Lauren and I were writing the book, we shared a lot with each other while we were writing the book, and we realized that we had been on that same project just 20 years apart. 20 years apart, because she and I are at least 20 years apart in age. I was there to bring in the entities. And I was there witnessing them setting up base camps and with their meetings they used to have with, you know, I was there also with, they were creating bodies for these entities. Not all of them had bodies. This is some crazy stuff, but it's serious. This is so serious. So now I'm trying to remember where I was. I was kind of going all over the place with this. Anyway, well, the light beings, a lot of people are thinking these things are of God. They're not of God. These are the ones we brought in back in the early 80s to set up the base camps. It was all part of the project to fool Christians, to fool all kinds of people, to the point where you won't be able to tell the difference between a so-called New Ager and a Christian and a Luciferian. You know, believing and doing the same things. They may think they're separate, but they're not. They're practicing the same stuff. So who do you think, you know, you're doing all, some people are doing, they think they're doing spiritual warfare, whether like out in the cosmos or whatever, and they're astral traveling, they call it, traveling in the spirit. They're not traveling in the spirit. They're doing this, they're astral traveling. You can call it whatever you want, but it's not, it's the same thing as astral traveling. You are in Satan's domain. You are not serving God. You know how you can take the enemy, take territory? I mean, the battle, like what Lauren and I have written in our book and in articles that Lauren's written, the territory is our heart, all right? That, the territory Satan wants is our heart. When you follow Jesus Christ and you follow his ways, think about that. You keep the doors closed to the occult when you're following Jesus Christ. You can have discernment by following Jesus Christ. But you aren't going to have discernment opening the door to the dark side. Remember what I said about how I saw the words the Christ when it wasn't the words after all? Back when I was serving the hierarchy, it's because I had opened the doors to them. I was being driven by the demonic, not the Spirit of God. Now, you cannot be guided by the Holy Spirit of God when you're messing with the demonic. If you even have a doubt in your mind that what you're doing is of the demonic or not. A friend of mine years ago said, when in doubt, do without. In that situation, that would apply. If you don't know, then don't do it. You're better off picking up your cross, following Jesus exactly how he said. Go back to the Bible and see what Jesus said. See how he told you to live. Live in truth. You know, what's righteousness? You're supposed to be righteous living instead of, I mean, people are out there in the cosmos or whatever. They're out in the astral thinking they're battling demons. Well, let me tell you, they're not battling demons. The best way to battle demons is to follow Jesus Christ. It's to walk in truth. It's to live a righteous life. If you don't know what living a righteous life is, go look it up in the Bible. Find out what righteousness is. Speaking truth, living truth. A lot of times in the Bible, you'll find out what the wicked, if you look up one of the term, the wicked or the evil ones, you know, or the heathen, see what the Bible says that they do. Well, don't do those. You know, God says don't do that. So don't. Because if you do, you open the door to the occult, the dark side, demonic influence. You may not feel like that's happening. Like you may wake up and think, yeah, I feel fine. You know, it's not bothering me. Well, you know what? It creeps up on you, or you may think you feel fine where you might be deceived. So don't take a chance. It's not worth it. And although I said ages ago I was going to quit, I was going to quit talking. There are a couple of things I didn't finish up, but I guess like the part where the reason I left the spiritual hierarchy. One of the there's a lot of things that happened. It's really kind of complicated, and I've written it before and explained it and had it on my blog, although I took it down because it was one of the videos that when I'd explained it, it was one of the videos I've done before with a certain person that he took them down. I don't know why, but I just decided to take it off my blog for now, and then I was going to rewrite my story. And although there's a lot of good that I covered about my story. But what I wrote in my blog article actually explained it better. So maybe perhaps I should put that back up. But anyway, when you get up in Satan's hierarchy, I know where I left off. Gosh, I went on a rabbit trail. In order, stepping way back, where they needed me to... They wanted me to know who the leader really was in order for me to continue my work that was in the project, bringing in those light beings, and to know who AI was, the first one that came through the portal, to understand that part of the plan from their perspective, which was that they don't serve God. That, I mean, you're right, I chuckled a little bit there for the people that criticize me for laughing. Sometimes it's a nervous laugh, you know, because it's just sometimes things are just so crazy, you know, so I'll give a little chuckle. So please forgive me if I laughed over there. It isn't funny, you know, about Lucifer. It's not funny at all. That's why I'm spending so much time talking to you here. They needed me to know, or wanted me to know, that they wanted me to know that who they served was not God, that their God was Lucifer, and that Lucifer's Satan. So they introduced me to him. It was actually in the astral realm first. Well, actually, yeah, the astral realm, which to me is no different than physically there. It's like I was there and the perception was there. And a lot of work goes on in the astral. I mean, there's things that happen, schools and things, that there's a lot of work happens there in the different realms. And that's something you shouldn't be messing with. People, Christians, are out there thinking they're that's part of Satan's trickery. There is sending, is teaching, is people wanting you to go out and venture into the realms, because that's Satan's territory. But there's nothing scripturally sound that's not God's teaching, that's not Jesus' ways, and there's a reason why you're not supposed to be involved in that. You know, you're losing yourself when you're doing that, losing your life, really. Maybe, you know, I don't know, I probably don't come across strong enough. I don't know how to make it known that, you know, people have a choice. They can believe what I'm saying, and I'm sending you back to the Word of God. How are you going to lose by that? How are you going to lose? You aren't going to get stupid because you've gone back to the Word of God and followed Jesus. If you call yourself a Christian, shouldn't you be following Him? So, okay, so back on, I was presented to Lucifer, to Satan, and I'm not going to say too much about it. People are disappointed that I don't. I don't like to think about him, and he can appear as a very handsome man. He can appear whatever he wants to. That's pretty much how any of those things can do. So you can't, in this instance, you can't judge them by the cover, you know, the book by the cover, because you have to have that spiritual discernment that comes from God to know the difference. And you aren't going to get the discernment by studying the occult. Don't study the occult to think that you're going to learn how to identify what is not of God. The only way you're going to know what is not of God is to study God's Word. Seek Him first. Seek only Him. It's, you know, then His Holy Spirit will guide you. Don't fall for the lie that you need to go study the dark side and know everything about it. No, you better be an expert on Jesus Christ and walking. You need to walk in His ways. How are you going to know what's of God and what isn't? Well, if you're walking, if you picked up your cross and you're following Jesus, then you're going to know, you're going to have better discernment. And when you don't, you're not going to have godly discernment. It's going to be, it could be demonically inspired. So be safe. So anyway, yeah, I met Satan, and they made it clear who they were. I didn't want to believe it. I didn't want to believe that I spent my whole life serving Satan and furthering a plan against God. And in order for me to fully understand who they are, and who they are. For me to fully understand them and the plan, they had to tell me who Jesus Christ really is. And He is Savior. They know that. They know who He is. He's their enemy. They hate Him. They hate anything to do with God and goodness and Christianity. They hate you. But they're destroying you by feeding you lies, and it's deception. So, yeah, Satan, I mean, It's a weird way to learn the truth. It really is. But I thank God that God got me out. I mean, part of my story at that time, God was really working to help me. I mean, talk about timing. I was infiltrating a church at that time with there were like seven of us. And I actually said started reading my Bible and was finding out that, well, I mean, I got in trouble with the person that was in charge of me. She was actually like my physical master. They call them masters. I mean, she would be, some people call her handler. Yeah, she was a handler, but she was in the spiritual hierarchy and like the top levels. And I got in trouble for reading the Bible because I was told not to, you know, don't you dare read that. And because I might actually see that in context, what they were teaching me was wrong. Well, I actually found out that the church had some stuff wrong too. But in the meantime, that was just another interesting thing about that. There were some people in that church that actually had some spiritual discernment. They knew what we were. Most of them didn't. They just thought maybe that my leader, the person that was head of our group, was Holy Spirit filled and had gifts and all that. I mean, at the occult church, she was like the top person everybody sought out because of her so-called gifts. And in the Christian church, they didn't know the difference. And a lot of those people had false gifts too. I recognize that. But there were a few people there that knew what we were. And I thank God for them. That they, because it showed me that there was some godly discernment in that church. And because I needed to see that. So there was a person in that church that gave me a book, it's like I was going through a lot of, I just didn't know what to do, because after I found out it was Satan, and I knew they could kill me. You know, I had a family and everything. They could kill me. It was scary. I didn't know what to do. And somebody at the church gave me this book. First he asked me, you know, he said, what are your views on the afterlife? And I said, well, you know, I don't know anymore. I don't know what to think. I'm mixed up. And he said, well, I think this book will help you. And he gave it to me. And it was The Beautiful Side of Evil by Johanna Michelson. And that book, you know, I have an article. It's like that book saved my life pretty much. It's because I read the book. I could tell that she had been involved in the dark side. You know, you just can tell if you're involved in the dark side, and you can tell if somebody else is lying or not, whether it's a made up something or another. But I could tell she knew what she was talking about. So when it got to the part where she was talking about the progression of her own story, her own testimony, and when she got to the part about who Jesus is, and finding out that he is Savior, and how she ended up renouncing everything, her past in a cult. I mean, she went a long way from the beginning of the book to when she gave her life to Jesus Christ. There's a big, she went a long way in belief systems, but it happened. And when I read that book, I realized that I could trust, you know, I believed her. And I thought, okay, well, I can trust in Jesus then. I'm going to take a chance. You know, I thought, I'm going to take a chance. I'm going to tell them I'm out. So what I did, I had a personal meeting with my mentor, who was like pretty much pretty high in the hierarchy. And I told her when she was trying to tell me more about Lucifer. And I just told her, I said, I don't buy it. I'm not doing this anymore. I'm out. And that they're liars. And that I'm giving my life to Jesus Christ. And it's funny because, no, it isn't funny, but It's like she couldn't believe I would do that. See, they wanted me to give my life to Satan, to serve him. That was like a trophy. A trophy, you know, people think that they can't, that they're saved, you know, like they give their life to Jesus Christ and they're, and they say they give their life to Jesus Christ, but they don't really. You know, they may, I mean, Jesus died for everybody. I mean, that's, look in the Bible, it's scriptural, totally scriptural. You know, if I'm wrong, you'll find out. Just read the Bible. Jesus died for everybody. But you have to want that. You have to believe he is who he is, who he says he is, Son of God, Savior. You have to believe that with your heart and your whole heart and know that. And then trust enough in it. Okay, well, that's the first step. Well, what are you going to do after that? You know, well, in my case, I had to renounce everything. Repent. Well, repent can happen every single day of your life. You can actually walk away from God and not even realize it. You can be serving Satan. Call yourself a Christian, but you're serving Satan. Where's that going to get you? If you think that's going to get you to heaven, I encourage you to look at the Bible and see. Check it out. There's lots of scriptures. One of them is in Revelation. Lots of scriptures that say that you must obey God, that you have to be living righteous life. You know, none of us are perfect. All you have to do is ask God for help. But if I'd given my life to Jesus Christ and gone back and just been, I would have been serving Satan. Like if you a little bit at a time, you know, you can fail a little bit at a time and little farther, and you get farther and farther away from God. Well, one, Satan's biggest trophy, at least this is what maybe he has a bigger trophy, but one of his big trophies is a Christian that knows who Jesus Christ is, that Jesus Christ is Savior, that they've given their lives to Jesus Christ, but then they turn on him and they consciously decide to serve Satan. Now, I was at that point where they wanted me to consciously serve Satan. So, I couldn't do that. You know, some people out there they're unconsciously serving Satan. And I encourage everybody, that's nothing to be messing around with. Maybe I'm wrong about that you may not make it to heaven, but you need to, even if you think you will make it to heaven and you're living like Satan, I mean, there's little, like people call white lies, they start getting, falling into maybe jealousies, or there's just all kinds of things that people can fall into. Little by little, they get farther and farther away from God. They aren't serving God. I'm just telling you to be careful. And if you find anything in your life that is not, that seems to be, you can do better, well, try to do better and ask God to help you. Don't beat yourself up. Just ask God to help you. If you fail, then get up and try again. You know, we're not perfect. None of us. I mean, you read the Bible, none of those people are perfect. And even though I said I was going to stop, there's one thing I left out. It was that I have said in other videos, and I apologize for how long this thing is. And it's the story about the most illumined of all. And that's probably the scariest thing I've ever experienced in my life. And I have seen a lot of scary stuff. I really have. I mean, some scary stuff. Some terrible things. This is the worst. But it wasn't scary like a lot of people would think scary. It's scary because of the deception. That was after I was introduced to Satan in a male form. I do believe that this was Satan, that the second time too. I've gone back and forth wondering, and I really do believe it was Satan. And the story, I've written a story, and it's still on my blog. And it's, I think it's under Final Initiation Part 2. It might be that, or Final Initiation. Or you can just go to my blog and use the search for Most Illumined of All. I didn't call him that. That's what they call him. This happened like right after I've been bringing in light beings from the portal, and they, like I said, they needed humans to open up, use the energy of humans to open up the portal. They need humans for a lot of stuff. So, they get their energy from you too. That's a whole nother story. Okay. So I didn't know why I was being taken to this church. It was like a cathedral, and I was in the astral, but to me I could have been there physically. It's the same thing. I wasn't there physically, but I'm saying it was no different. It's like I was trained in the astral to be as aware. Actually, it's more aware than in the physical, and that's because they needed me for that. It was my life training. My whole life I was trained for that. My whole life's training led up for that project. That's what they trained me for. That's why they didn't want to let me go, is because they spent all those years training me so that I would be the person they could use for this particular project, bringing in those beings. So when we went into this church, it was like a cathedral. I don't know where it is. I kind of wished I would have asked, but later, I mean, there's a lot of stuff, and you just don't ask. If they don't tell you, you usually don't ask. I shouldn't say that. You just don't ask. I was in a white robe, and so was my master. That was our attire, white robes. And I was taken into this cathedral. We walked in through like a side door, and there were pews there, like, you know, cathedral. We walked down the aisle, and when I was walking down the aisle with her, she started walking behind me, and I was wondering, what are we doing here? Then all of a sudden, this huge light just materialized in front of me, like at the front of the church where the altar is. And it was like, I could see it. This is weird. I could see it through the ceiling, through the sky. It was, and I've said stories and stories tall. It's, I don't know, it could have been 60 stories tall. It was huge, just bright, bright, shining, you know, like blinding bright light. And, you know, I'm wondering, what's this? And then I realized that my master was standing a little behind me. I realized, yeah, there's something going on. This is kind of like, when anything like that happens, they're presenting me to something, or it's a lesson. So, I was just kind of amazed at it, and I looked behind to see what she was doing, and she just gave a nod and smiled, and that was that. Everything that I'm doing, everything okay so far. Well, then I had the feeling that they wanted something from me. They wanted me to give my impression. Well, at that point, I was just kind of shocked. I didn't have much of an impression. So then all of a sudden, I knew it was a male entity. I could sense that. Then all of a sudden, the thing was just overwhelming. And I describe it as like sensory overload. It was like it felt like that it was Jesus. I mean, I've said that I think that all of us, somewhere in us, know the Spirit of God. We know what Jesus is, the personality. We know him, but maybe not consciously. But it was like, it just shocked me. I thought, it's Jesus. I mean, it had all the purity. It had godliness, unconditional love, everything you can think of that's goodness and beauty and love. That thing was radiating it. So I mean, the first thing I wanted to do was run toward it and embrace. It was like I wanted to be with it. And I just leaned forward. And then all of a sudden it was like, you know, if you get like a little, kind of like a wave that goes over you, like an emotion thing. It's like all of a sudden it was like something just like, whew, like this. And it was like, no, something's wrong. It's like, it's not Jesus. It was like a slight, just a very, very slight thing in me just said, it was just comparing to what Jesus was. Well, you know, the Jesus I met when, well, I didn't meet him, but that I learned about from reading the Bible when I was 12, when I told you about that, the Good News for Modern Man, I understood a little bit more about who Jesus was. So that was what it was. That was what was inside of me that I remembered. It's like I didn't know what born again was back when I was 12. Nobody taught it. Nobody said I needed to be born again. And I don't even like that term really, but that's what happened to me. You know, when I look back, I know that's what happened to me. So I had an understanding, maybe the Spirit of God differently. I don't fully understand how that happened, but it's like I knew more who Jesus was because of that. So here I was standing before that entity. And then when that wave came across me and I'm thinking, no, it isn't Jesus. So I pulled back. And then all of a sudden it was like magnified again, like overtaking me, the feeling it's Jesus, all that goodness and the love and the unconditional love. And I leaned forward to go run toward him again. And all of a sudden it was again, I felt it's not Jesus. And then happened a third time. It came over me and I thought, oh yeah, this is Jesus. I know it's him. And I started, this time I was ready to go toward him. I was leaning forward and then the wave came across me again. It's something so small in me telling it it's not him. So I was puzzled. I looked back at my master. I could tell the entity was pleased. I didn't know why at that time. I looked back at my master, and she was pleased, too. She was beaming. It was weird. The light that was coming off of her was just even more light coming off of her. She was demonic, and yet light's coming off of her. You know, it's just because something has light around it doesn't mean it's of God. So please don't trust that stuff. And, you know, if you want to know how angels behave, that's not usual that angels appear to people. Go to the Bible and find out when they showed up, why they did. I mean, it's a rarity. And there's a reason why God makes it a rarity. Now people are falling for this stuff. You know, I was used to promote that idea too. You know, I'm sorry for it. And I was wrong. Okay, I was dead wrong. I would have been dead wrong. So anyway, back to the story. Little commercial break. They were both pleased. I passed the test. Whatever it was that I thought it was Jesus but wasn't Jesus. Well, the next morning, the phone rang. And I answered the phone. It was my master, the physical female master. And she said, first word, she didn't say, hello, how are you, none of that stuff. She goes, well, what did you think of him? Those are her first words. And I just said, who was he? Who is that? And then her voice got really dreamy sounding, and she goes, he's the most magnificent, he's the most wonderful, he's the most illumined of all. Well, you know, I was thinking, my first thought was, okay, he's the most illumined of all the entities we brought through the portal. And he's definitely that. But, you know, because he was a light, he chose to, at that point, to show himself as a light being, like an angel of light. Well, he didn't come through the portal like the rest of those ones. Some of them, you know, like ones I mentioned before, AI, and these were warring angels that came through the portal. They were not very nice at all. I wondered why. That was when I was wondering why these entities were supposed to be. This is before I found out I was working for Satan. You know, I was thinking these are not good. Well, I don't believe there should be any. Why are they working for God? They can't be working for God if they're like this. And I was told, well, they're just, you know, they're warring angels, and that's how they are. So I just thought, okay, all right. But I found out later what they really are. But anyway, this entity, I can't say 100% sure that I'm 100% sure that it's Satan, but I'm like pretty much 99.9% maybe, you know, pretty close. Because who else would be what they would consider the most illumined of all? They consider Satan the most illumined of all. You know, he likes to be called Lucifer. He likes to be called Satan. He is Satan and he is Lucifer. So the lie that there's two separate entities, I mean, like I said, that's a lie. They're one and the same, okay? And anyway, the reason I brought that up, and the reason I say it's the most scariest thing in the world is because, the most scariest I've ever experienced, is because I've thought that if that happened again, if I was put to the test, I don't know that I'd pass. I'm hoping now that as I spend more time in the Bible, what I call the Word of God, the written Word of God, don't believe those lies where people are telling you that's part of the plan, that people are telling you that the Bible's outdated, that the Bible has been messed with, and all that kind of stuff. Don't believe those lies. There's enough evidence otherwise. You know, read it for yourself. Don't let somebody talk you out of eternal life. That's it. Don't let somebody ruin it for you, okay? Because the Satan is so deceptive, so deceptive. So I don't know. I hope I would pass it again. But the whole point, too, is another reason why I spend this time talking, trying to help people see that this is nothing to mess around with, that Satan is real, that this is not like a movie, TV show, that reality show thing, and everything's going to be okay, and this is reality. Satan is real. We have a savior because we need a savior. God only needed one way. He sent the word. If you read the book of John, also Hebrews, he's the word of God. He's the living word. You know, we have a written word. He's the living word of God. He's the bread of life. He's the living water. He's I don't know, there's other terms that he calls himself that he is. He's the way, the truth, and the life. I look at it this way too. Why do we need one savior? Well, when you think about, we don't have to fully understand it. It's the fact that I look at it as like a lifesaver. You know, that people have those on the side of the pool, the throw to somebody who might be drowning. It's a life preserver. It's like God sent that from heaven. He threw it out to us because we are in a dying, sinking world that's going to hell. You know, that's pretty much it. It just is. You know, it's fallen. He loves us so much that he did what it took. We don't understand all of this. We don't have to, but it took him somehow or another. He needed to atone for our sins, pay for them. And who could do that? I think about everything in my everyday life. You know, how many times do I sin? How many times do I fall short? Am I perfect? I'm far from perfect. How about, that's one day. How about in a year? How many times in a day, and how many times in a year have I done something? My thoughts. I may have thoughts that are bad. It's just, and if I entertain them, it could mean it darkens my own heart. That's part of the fallen world. That's the killer. That identifies me with the world, with the fallen part. When I am doing something that is of the fallen nature. You know, how do you be, we're not, okay, so I'll go back to to that example. Will you take just one person, me, you know, a whole year? All right, I'm almost 65 years old. How many times has a 65-year-old woman fallen short? Not just in action, how about thoughts? You know, maybe more than some people, maybe less. That's one person. Think about all the people on the face of the earth today. Think about every human being that's lived on the earth since the beginning of time, since the beginning of the earth. From the time, from the beginning of earth until the time the earth is gone. Every single person. Who is going to clear the slate? It takes God Himself. God Himself paid the price. It can't be done by a human. There's no such thing as reincarnation. That is one of the biggest lies there is that Satan's put out there, reincarnation. It's not true. So God sent His Son, Jesus Christ, who we know is Jesus Christ, you know. It doesn't, you know, you may call Him Yeshua, you may call Him Yeshua, there's other names. It, you know, in a supernatural, you know, you don't, what's He called in the supernatural? It doesn't matter. God knows who He is, Satan knows who He is, He paid the price. And He paid it for everybody. So He is the life-saver, life-preserver sent to us if we want. All you have to do is accept that. You know, you have to believe who He is first. If you don't know who He is, go to the Bible, read in context, find out who He is. Ask God to help you. Help you understand. He will. God loves you. He doesn't want you to be lost. He doesn't want you to be deceived. So many people are deceived right now. You know, you get even a small layer of deception, and it takes you away from understanding God and understanding how serious this is. And even it keeps you from understanding God and being guided by God. So, I don't know. It's... I could talk forever, but sometimes short videos are going to be, they'll probably be a lot better, but anyway, I know it's been one thing after another because I haven't done videos and there's been a lot on my heart, and I kind of touched on a lot of topics a little bit here, and I'll go in depth later, and anyway, if you stayed this long listening, you know, thank you, and pray God blesses you, and pray that we all see each other in the eternal life, and, you know, one day we'll have physical bodies. That's, if I understand correctly, you know, I'm still studying the Bible, but there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. I totally believe that. And the resurrection, Jesus was resurrected. And the Bible says we will too. And there's going to be a resurrection of the righteous and the unrighteous. You know, and the judgment. With what I've seen, I mean, that may sound like kind of far off and maybe isn't going to happen, even to a lot of Christians today. From where I've come from, It may be a while, but I fully believe that in God's plan, what he says in the Bible. I've known too well the dark side and his plan to destroy you, that God's plan is definitely real, and his plan is for us all to be saved. He doesn't want to lose a single one of us, and for us to have eternal life, but we have to, I mean, he provided a way for us. It's like, I don't understand why people think that there should be many ways. It's like, that's a lie from Satan. It's, the way's been provided and made for you. Take it. Take it. And pick up your cross and follow Jesus. You know, renounce all your past that's been ungodly. And follow God. It's, you know, little by little. I mean, it's a day at a time thing. Step by step thing. You can do it. I mean, if you're not serving him, you're serving Satan. So anyway, I'll just, you know, say goodbye to everybody. Sorry for the long video, and hope to be seeing you guys sometime soon, some people, and see everybody in the hereafter, in the new heaven and new earth. I totally believe it. So, love you guys. Praying for you. And I want to thank everybody for praying for me too. So, bye.